Hello, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen, and I am the program manager for NCWIT Counselors for Computing. It's my pleasure to bring you this ninth webinar in the series hosted by NCWIT C4C. Each month, we have connected you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a really unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields. And we also call that CS plus X. Throughout the presentation, we would really love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the Zoom toolbar. And we will also be sharing resources in the chat feature, which can also be found on your Zoom toolbar. To tell you a little bit about NCWIT, or the National Center for Women in Information Technology, we are a nonprofit community of more than 1,400 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. And what NCWIT does is we equip change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. So before NCWIT, these programs focusing on women in computing, they existed mostly in isolation. So without the benefit of these shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or the national reach. Today, these programs are all a part of the NCWIT community, and they are creating a far greater impact than if any of these institutions acted alone. And Counselors for Computing, or C4C, we are one of the programs in that NCWIT K-12 Alliance. So to tell you a little bit about C4C, our program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to those transformative computing careers. And we wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM. They are the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. And DoD STEM offers educational programs and internships and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for you as educators. We've shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. And I would now like to introduce our speaker, Olivier Delalue. Olivier is a research engineering manager at Meta AI. He joined that in 2019, and his main research interest is in reinforcement learning to help AI agents better reason about the world around them. And he's also worked as a research assistant in academia and an AI programmer in the video games industry. So it's going to be really relatable to your students. With that, I would also like to introduce Steve Sharp, who will be running the Q&A at the end of this webinar. Steve is a school counselor and Apple certified educator. He has worked to provide students with the knowledge and skills to be healthy and successful in the 21st century. He frequently presents on technology, emerging career skills, mental health, and race in education. And I want to thank you both for being here today. And with that, I want to remind everyone to please use that Q&A feature on the Zoom toolbar, and we will make sure that we answer your questions at the end of the session. And I would now like to have you enjoy this presentation from Olivier Delalue of Meta.
Thanks a lot, Kelsey. Let me share my screen real quick. All right, so today I'm here, very excited to be here to tell you about my personal view on machine learning in academia and industry. So I talk a little bit about myself, and actually you'll see I talk actually a lot about myself for the presentation, the ideas, and I want to make this clear, it's really going to be a very personal view. So disclaimer is going to be somewhat biased and somewhat narrow because this is based on my own experience. Don't hesitate to go out there and also find other opinions that are going to be, you know, just at least as valid as the one I'm giving you today. I want to talk a bit about what it means to do machine learning in academia, in industry, how they differ, and also what are steps for people who are interested into getting started into these careers. How do you get there? How do you get these jobs? Then make sure to be sometime at the end to have some Q&A session. So starting about myself, I'm an engineering manager at Meta, part of the broader AI organization at Meta. I support a team of four research engineers in the Montreal office of Fair Montreal. And my research interests and expertise are about what's called reinforcement learning. I don't have time to go into the details, but that's basically about training AIs that are learned to accomplish tasks by themselves without being told exactly how they should do it. So just to give you a couple of examples, one project I've been involved in is about controlling the rate of at which you send data over the network, over the internet, to optimize some quality, for instance, for video chat. Maybe a more fun example is playing video games. This is a project I've been doing back when I was at Ubisoft. Here you can see in orange, it's an AI that was trained with reinforcement learning and it's fighting a hand design AI. And you can see like the orange one is winning, which means it has managed to learn how to play the game in order to play successfully. So that's basically me now. How I got there, it's a bit of a more basic game you can see here. So that's a game I wrote myself back when I was about 10. And yes, at that time I was already into computers and programming. So I kind of continued in the same vein. Fast forwarding a bit, I just want to give you a high level overview. Top row is French stuff. You don't have to understand it. I put the equivalent university one at the bottom. Essentially, I went through a typical university path, then decided I wanted to get a job. So I started as a research assistant, then decided, oh, after all, maybe I should be doing a PhD. So I did a PhD as well. Then I started working in the industry, first at Ubisoft and then at Meta. Just wanted to give you this high-level view. Now let's get started with the real meat of the presentation and what it means to do machine learning in academia. And the first thing I want to talk about is what are all these different degrees and what do we get you? Because you may think, okay, should I do a bachelor? Should I do a master of science? Should I do a PhD? The answer is you can do any of this, all are valid paths, but I want to explain a bit more what are the trade-offs here. So if you get just a bachelor, it's actually already great. Typically, this is going to be enough to get a job more as a generic software engineer, and it's going to be up to you to kind of move your way into the company that you're in to go get into these more machine learning oriented jobs. But with a bachelor, usually you're not considered a machine learning expert at this point. If you want to get more machine learning or focused job, you may want to pursue a master of science, which is going to give you a more in-depth knowledge of some specific domain in ML. It's also a good way, I think, a master's to get some first contact with the research world, get a feel of what it's like so that you know, oh, do I actually want to continue in a PhD or no, it's not for me, I want to do something else. So obviously you don't have to do a machine learning engineering job after a master, but it's a good way to unlock them. I would say as well, it's totally possible to stay in academia, but take a role which is more about supporting like your research lab, being a research assistant or a software developer to develop tools and libraries for your research lab. Now, if you do enjoy research, you're probably going to want to actually do a PhD. PhDs typically are very in-depth and narrow. So you're really going to, to narrow down a specific topic, become an expert in there. You're going to get a full picture of what it's like to work in academia in terms of, publishing papers, going at conferences, talking at conferences, connecting with researchers, other researchers, professors, students. And what this unlock is the same kind of roles you could have as a master typically, but you may start maybe at a higher level of seniority. And as well, what's called research scientists in the industry, research scientists versus research engineers, they're actually pretty close in practice. The main difference, without going into too many details, engineers are typically more hands-on and more focused on development. Scientists are typically more focused on the ideation, algorithmic side of things, and more like the mathematics behind it. But that's, it's always a bit blurry, so don't take that as a crisp categorization. And you may also want to keep working in academia, in which case, like the next logical step post-PhD is actually, a postdoc. I'll get back to that in a couple of minutes. First, maybe just to give an illustration of what I did myself. I actually started in the military because I was doing this French engineering school, which is a military school as well. So that's me on the right. It's weird French stuff. I won't go into it. Just one thing I want to mention is I did get lucky because the reason why I got into machine learning is thanks to my roommate. That was at the point where I had no clue what class to take. My roommate told me, oh, we can do this degree, actually. It sounds fun. I was like, I'm not sure it's fun, but I'll be with you, so let's do that. It turns out it was really, first, it was fun, and second, I didn't know I was getting into this field that was going to really blow up later. So I got lucky in that regard. I also got lucky because I got my first job in the research lab of Yoshua Bengio. If you don't know Yoshua Bengio, he's one of the top world best known scientists in the world. At that time, he wasn't, so which was good for me because it was easier to get into his lab. And finally did this PhD. What I would say is that finished at 33 years old. I was happy it was done essentially at that time. So that's how I did it myself. Now, this is how I see things, the typical path you want to do machine learning in academia. And this is probably applies to more than machine learning, but machine learning is what I know about. Typically as a student, you're going to go through this bachelor, master, PhD path. And if you want to continue essentially the path toward being a professor, you do your postdoc and then you kind of go through the different ranks of professor, get tenure, which gives you job stability essentially. But at some point you may want to branch out of this path to professor, right? And I want to make it clear, like these are typical branching points. They are not the only way you can get out of this. Obviously, every path is unique. So you can stay in academia, I mentioned it earlier. There are different kinds of role in academia, like being a research assistant, where you can do some support for a research lab, or you can move to the industry, either as a software engineer, more machine learning, research-oriented engineer, or this research scientist role that I mentioned before. As an example, this is my PhD class back in 2008. Most people are blurred for privacy reasons, except myself in the middle and one of my Meta colleagues, Pascal Vincent, who's now a research scientist as well as a professor. So just to give you, some examples of what people doing a master or PhD in machine learning may become. Our professors are still there, but some became professors, some became research scientists, some became research engineers. One was more on the entrepreneur doing startup things. Two became research directors. We have one also software engineer. So different kinds of positions that you can share after this kind of curriculum. I want to give a few tips about people who want to go far in academia, how to succeed. At least I went all the way to PhD. I didn't go further, so take this from my limited experience. One, which I think is the most important, is you need to have this drive to get things done by yourself. So you need to be autonomous. You need to persevere through challenges, because academia is a rather unstructured environment. And as a result, there may be nobody really to push you to get things done. So you have to push yourself. The other thing I want to mention is you need to have this curious mind that's excited and willing to read about papers, write down your own ideas, figure out how they fit together. You need some creativity in there. So it really comes from your inner self as well, that if you want to push forward the field of science, it has to come from somewhere and typically come from yourself and desire to learn and discover and come up with new ideas. The last point I wanted to mention is very few people are successful alone. Very often someone who's successful in academia or elsewhere, I would say, but in academia is definitely true as well. It can feel lonely as a student, or you know, just by myself doing my work. In practice, the people who are around you contribute a lot to your success, both during your academia, but also after. So, you know, you need to go out to conferences, listen to people, talk to people, show yourself out there, share your work, do some internship to get to know more people, build some potential future collaborations, and so on. So don't think that you're going to be just alone at your desk and do things on your own. That's not how it works. So that's what I wanted to say about academia. Now I'm going to talk a bit more about doing machine learning in the industry, which I guess I have more experience with since most of my time has been spent in industry as of today. There are different roles you can take as doing machine learning in industry. I want to say a few words about some of this, which I highlighted on the left. Just to give you a little glimpse of the different kinds of things that someone may do with machine learning in industry. So one is the machine learning engineer is typically someone who's going to build some applied end-to-end machine learning based system. So one example could be, for instance, recommending, Facebook groups. When you open the Facebook app, it tells you, hey, you could join this group. Typically, this is built underlying, there are some kind of machine learning based recommender system. And there's a whole process of data collection, building the model, training the model, but also monitoring the model, making sure it's scaled so that when tons of people access it, it doesn't fail. And this is typically what machine learning engineers do, so kind of building the whole thing from start to finish. Then you have a research engineer and research scientist roles that are typically more on research focused initiatives, so they may be a bit less applied. You can have some applied research, some more fundamental research, but typically they are less to really feel a specific need right now in a product, but more about to build the stuff that's going to later become useful in products, but maybe not right now. Engineers, like I said earlier, they are more hands-on, more on software development. Scientists are more on algorithmic and science side of things. Data scientists actually are pretty close to machine learning engineers. There is some overlap, so they may do the same thing that I just said before. I would say also typically there is a good amount of data science work that is more behind the scene in some sense, and more about looking at the data that is being collected and understanding it and trying to get business insights out of it. So for instance, at Ubisoft, think you're playing a game. Actually, what you're doing in the game is being tracked, sent to some servers, and there is a data scientist that's going to look at what kind of moves you're using in the game, where are you dying, when are you leaving the game, and try to figure out what needs to be improved in the game and the future iterations of the game in order to get you to enjoy it more, essentially. So these are typical roles. The last one is a bit special. It's about being a manager. It's probably not something I think it's something that most people don't think of as their first job, and I think that's the right approach. In particular, I wouldn't advise someone to become a manager without having done some this kind of really technical work, because personally, myself, whenever I have a manager who can actually provide me technical feedback on what I'm doing, understand what I'm doing, it feels much better than when I have a manager who has no clue what I'm doing and they'll say, hey, good job, Olivier, it looks great. That's nice, but it's not really helpful to grow. So if you're planning to become a manager in the future, I do encourage you to go through these steps of actually doing the work yourself, understanding what it's about so that you can really support your reports in a meaningful way. Maybe just also something I want to mention as a manager is something that's true at Meta. It's definitely not true in all companies, but something I enjoy at Meta is being a manager, becoming a manager is not a promotion. It's more like you have two parallel tracks of manager and non-manager, and you can jump back and forth between the two without it considered either a promotion or a demotion. And it's really more about what you enjoy doing. The set of skills obviously is different. And I think that's the right way to think about being a manager, and not, oh, after X years, I should be a manager. Otherwise, you know, I'm not progressing in my career. So that's how we encourage you to think of things. All right. Just, you know, give you some insight about what I've been doing myself. At Ubisoft, I've been there 7 years. I wore many hats, including something online programmer, which has nothing to do with actual machine learning. But it was a lot of fun to do a multiplayer of Watch Dogs. It was the first game I appeared on the credits. I got the chance to be on a few games credit, which is fun. But at some point, you know, I wanted to do a bit less applied research, which is why I joined Meta and got this nice opportunity to become a manager at the same time. I wanted to say a bit more about, you know, what is the difference between doing a machine learning career in industry versus in academia. And again, so keep in mind, this is my own view. It's, you know, there's going to be exception to each of the bullet points here. But still, one thing to keep in mind is industry typically has, you know, there's going to be some products attached to it, which means the research is going to be more applied. Usually more structured. You have more expectations in terms of what you should be doing in your role. And, you know, there are more constraints because what you're representing the company, you're supposed to do something that's hopefully, maybe if it's even in 10 years, but, you know, something that should be useful at some point for the company. There are more constraints. People look more closely at what you're doing. So, you know, it may all sound relatively negative. I would say like the obvious positive points. I think there are more, like one positive point also is you can actually have some strong impact on actual users and build some really cool things. I should have put that in the slide. The other thing I put instead is, yes, usually the pay is better as well in the industry. I say industry until now. I just want to point out it's not only one industry. There are different type of industries, and I think each of them is going to give you a different flavor and different, it can actually be quite different way of working. So I would say typically you have these companies that are specialized in a specific domain. For instance, Ubisoft is doing video games. So if you join them, you're doing machine learning, definitely going to be really focused on video games. There is this set of big tech companies, so that used to be called FANG. I don't know if now it's called MANG, but FANG stood for Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Netflix, Google, which span, you know, these are really big companies that, yes, they have products, basically they have, you know, they also have AI teams that just do AI for the sake of AI and train to improve the state of the art in AI. So these offer, you know, more variety, I would say, compared to the first category. The last category would be startups. So these, you know, there are lots of cool things happening in startups, lots of cool startups starting with applying machine learning to tons of different applications. I think it's an exciting theme. I don't have any experience myself working in startups. I would say I see a lot of people going back and forth between, you know, big tech and startups. So it seems to be a fun thing to do. So it's something to consider as well. The one thing I would say is pretty much everybody agrees on, it's a bit riskier because, you know, you never know what's going to happen with a startup. So it's a bit of a gamble in terms of how it's going to turn out. So I was saying there are multiple types of industries, also multi types of works that you can do when you're doing machine learning in the industry. So it can be stuff really related, very applied, tied to specific products. So think examples are Meta would be detecting hate speech, doing some translation, video compression, doing some assistant for augmented reality, for instance. But you can also do very not applied research or more fundamental research. And here the goal is really to just advance the state of the art in AI. I have a few examples here of topics we are working on at Meta, for instance. And, you know, sure, it's about a lot about research, but research is often very little if you don't have code to go with it. So there's a lot of work as well on software development, building whatever platform and tools that you need in order to do all this cool research. I put here a few examples of cool projects at Meta, but you can find a lot of them open source on the web. It's also a very active field of, you know, just libraries and tools for AI. So if your goal, what I want to say by that as well is, you know, if you're more interested into software development than in the more scientific aspect of thing, you can definitely still do ML and do some really cool stuff in terms of software development as well. All right, now heading into the last part of my presentation. Hopefully this sounds exciting, but how do you get a job? How do you get to do one of these cool jobs, right? I would say, you know, the typical path, I think I mentioned it, you know, it's just do bachelor, master, PhD. It should put you in a good position to get a job. You can definitely do that. I put some branching point earlier. Don't think I have much more to say about that. I did wanted to mention as well, you can also decide not to do it the classical way, but say, oh, I'm just going to be learning by myself. There are lots of online classes. I wrote here the Papers with Code website, which is a really good website to look at, you know, what the latest research, but also it's organized. You have this method corpus. You can try to really to dig into specific topics and better understand all the research associated to different domains of machine learning. And of course, you know, you want to be coding some stuff as well. There are lots of open source projects you can decide to contribute to. So I put a link to the GitHub for our research group ourselves. So it's definitely something in theory, at least I would say, everything is out there if someone actually wants to learn everything by themselves. Like pretty much now everything is out there. What I would say is missing is, you know, a real curriculum, and at least, you know, kind of, I was seeing academia as unstructured, but there is still some structure to it. While here it's really doing it yourself, completely unstructured. So I would say, there is a danger though that we're seeing for people who are self-taught, where they don't have, for instance, the basic foundations in mathematics that they will need to really understand what they're doing, what's going on. And these people can quickly become limited because they know some of the basic things to do with what they know, typical tools, but they don't actually understand what's happening, and that can be dangerous. So I would say if you actually want to make a career and do it by yourself, make sure you don't skip, you know, the important stuff to really understand all the math, the theory, really play with it in depth and not just do some superficial course. So that's my advice on this. I just have this slide, really going to go quickly on it. Just wanted to mention a few typical tools that people would be using to get started. The programming language of choice is definitely Python. PyTorch, I think it's fair to say right now, is the most popular deep learning programming framework. Collab, Google Collaboratory is a very nice tool so that you can start programming on GPUs, even if you don't own a computer with GPU yourself. And there are a bunch of other tools and library you probably want to have some idea of if you want to have a career in there. There's a lot more there, lots of resources, so I'm not going to spend too much time on that. And yeah, I mean, you have tons of skills. You still need to get a job, right? So a few tips in order to get a job. One is you should, you know, I mentioned this before, but you know, you're usually not successful by yourself. So networking is important. You know, have some LinkedIn connections, go to conference, talk to people, visit the recruitment booths. Don't hesitate to join some special communities of different people working in AI and machine learning, as we can relate to them, build connections, and hopefully get some opportunities at some point. Internships are a great way to get jobs. I'm a living example of this. Different kinds of internships, some that are target actually starting from bachelor, you can get an internship, in which case pre going to be more, you know, software engineering focused rather than machine learning focused, but all the way to PhD, we can really do some cool research among top research scientists in the world. One thing I wanted to mention is for internships is don't hesitate to reach out to, directly reach out to researchers. So you need to do this work of identifying who they are, where there is matching interest and expertise. Typically at the end of the year, because that's when people start looking at interns for the summer. The reason I'm saying that is very often there are intern positions available on website. To be honest, based on my own experience, these tend to often go fall into the cracks very easily. So don't hesitate to be a bit pushy and reach out to people. Besides internship, there are other potential programs that can get you in. So I'm quoting two, they should be in the resources links. Essentially, I'm not going to spend too much time describing them, but they are programs that let you get a feel of what it's like to be working, for instance, here at Meta. And even if you may not be yet an AI expert, but you can still, you know, can still get a feel of what AI development is like and possibly get a job afterwards. And last few words on interviews, obviously, usually you have to have a choice. You have to go through that. One thing I want to mention is it's mostly about preparation. So don't skip preparation. Make sure you ask the recruiter what kind of interviews you're going to get through. You prepare for these specific types of interview, look up resources on the internet for tons of them. One example of program is this Above and Beyond Computer Science program from Meta, which is a program where students can practice mock interviews, typically by people from Meta like myself, who provide feedback and help them get better at this interview practice. So hopefully right now you have all the information in hand to be excited about going to a machine learning career, know how to get there, and I'm going to stop there and take some questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Olivier. That was really informative, and you told us a lot about getting these jobs at Meta. I'd like to invite Steve back on, and he is going to go ahead and start that Q&A.
Right now, Olivia, we have an overwhelming question appearing in the Q&A right now, and it is, what was in that blue glass?
I don't know, to be honest, but it didn't taste very good. So if you see something that is advertised as champagne that looks very bluish and sparky, don't buy it. It's overpriced and it's not worth it.
If we have time later on, can you talk about the process of training AI to recognize bad drinks in champagne glasses?
Yeah, maybe if we have time.
If we have time. So one of the first questions to get started is what got you interested in AI?
So I would say, like I said, it's the initial, thing was by chance, because my roommate told me, hey, there's this cool thing. I didn't find it that cool, but I thought, hey, I'm going to be with my roommate. That being said, you know, the interest started once I started taking courses, and I thought, oh, actually, you know, this is exciting. I can learn some cool thing. I can understand the data better. I started finding it more interesting. And I would say as well, the other aspect is video games. So like I said, I do enjoy video games. I've always, you know, enjoyed the AI aspect of video games as well. Initially, not at all from a machine learning point of view, but just in terms of building intelligent virtual characters, I've always found it fascinating. And, you know, how do we get agents, these non-player characters in virtual worlds that are really behave in a realistic way. That's just exciting to me.
Yeah, as a fan of the Rainbow Six series, I didn't realize so much frustration I felt for hours could actually be directly attributed to you. So thank you again for those lost weeks of my life.
My pleasure.
You know, like just kind of bridging off that, one question by Joanna was, what programming language do you work with the most? But I think a question I'd like to pivot off of that then is, how do you remain fresh and pick up new languages as really the field continues to grow?
So first, right now, Python is definitely the most used language in machine learning. So I would say, you know, if you have to start with one programming language, start with Python. I would say if you're targeting a software engineering role, I think it's good to know C++ as well, because sometimes you don't have a choice and you have to kind of dig deeper and look at some C++ code. And sometimes, you know, it just needs to go get this extra performance boost. And that's the kind of easiest and simplest way to get it. In terms of staying on top of things, I mean, I think it's something, you know, hopefully your company, that's a nice thing at Meta, where we are encouraged, you know, to use some of our time to keep learning new things. It's not that hard to keep an eye out on new things because, you know, you hear from the colleagues, you read Reddit, whatever. So you know what's kind of a cool new thing out there. The hard part is finding time to actually spend some time learning it. In which case, you know, hopefully it's something that your employer supports. If not, you have to do it on your own time. One thing I will mention is there are a lot of things that look cool and end up not, you know, surviving the test of time. So don't, I mean, unless you have a lot of time on your hands or really excited about just trying out all the new flashy things, it's also okay to just wait a bit and see what actually sticks versus it's just a fad. So you can be a bit selective here as well.
No, just kind of pivoting off that too, it leads me to just one question real quick. You've talked about how you fell in love with AI, you've talked about your continued learning process. The one question I have is, I mean, having a chance to read kind of your extensive bibliography of some of your published works, really, what do you feel is your biggest AI accomplishments or your biggest creation that you felt most satisfied with? Even if it's not something that would be as popular as some of, again, your frustrating AI characters, but maybe it is. Like, what is the one of your creations that you're most satisfied with?
Okay, so that's a tough one because I find myself often dissatisfied with the results. It's always okay. A bit frustrating. But that being said, I would say the work we did at Ubisoft on training agents. And I'm including multiple projects in there because we were using a shared code base and trying different things on different games. But I think that's what I think was the most exciting, because we're getting some really good results in terms of, you know, driving, for instance, a lot of different vehicles in a lot of different terrains, which usually would be really hard to do with typical things that people use in the game industry, for instance, and we're able to really get some really solid results. The reason I'm dissatisfied is the game actually got canceled and it never came out. But I think that was the one that was shaping up to be the most interesting and useful and impressive thing in terms of machine learning.
That's really awesome. I guess just kind of taking a, how, when we talk about kind of the process as far as developing some of these dense and immersive and really like expansive projects, how do you foster collaboration or how do you work with your teams?
So that's, there's a challenge, which is, in particular, I mean, the biggest challenge is going from research to production. So how do you turn something that looks cool when you have this nice, you know, paper and that describes something that was built on this really clean data set and really simple environment. And suddenly you say, okay, this looks really cool. Now I want to use that to actually improve a product. And now you have lots of concerns in terms of the reliability of the system, in terms of how do you get the data that you need? Is the data clean? Are there privacy issues with using this data? How often do I need to retrain my model? When I retrain it, is there a risk that just because machine learning is rarely deterministic, suddenly it's not going to be good just because I retrain it? How do I know that 5 years down the line, if there is a problem, someone's going to be able to understand what the problem is with the model? How do we fix it if it starts making wrong predictions? Lots of problems arise when you move to production. And it's often difficult to convince product teams that it's worth spending time on this for actually lots of good reasons. Like, there are challenges and they should not be ignored. The other thing I want to mention is product teams are very easily very happy to say yes when you tell them, I want to work to do this. What do you think? Yes, that sounds exciting. Who's working with me? Just do something great and we put it in this product, in this game, whatever. And that's the risk if you do that you end up doing stuff on your own, kind of struggling because you don't understand everything on the product side. Get back to the product team and say, it's not as exciting as imagined it would be. And we don't have bandwidth right now anyway to really integrate that in the product. So sorry. So the challenge is really, you really need to get a production team involved from the start, get them to invest some of their time, some of their resources in you, be there with you over the course of a project, make sure they learn these things as you go through the project so that they have the knowledge when it's time for the project is ready, so I can actually take ownership of this and maintain it for the foreseeable future. And it's something that's not trivial to do, but I think I talked enough on this topic, but I could do a whole presentation just on that.
Yeah, I mean, and that actually segues in, because there's an important question I was asked before. I mean, particularly with the wide range and varying projects that you work with and so many different levels of investment, how do you and your team identify and respond to bias in AI?
Bias in AI?
Yeah, or bias in machine learning in your algorithms, I think is just.
Oh, okay. Right. So I would say bias is definitely a problem, but it's going to be very much domain dependent. I've been lucky that I've been working on projects where it hasn't been a concern. So I'm not going to talk here really on my own experience. What I'm going to say is, this is something that's very relevant to a company like Meta, because we do a lot of predictive models. And when you train on data, that typically the bias is in the data and gets reflected in the model because of your data. It's very hard to figure out all the biases that are in the data. So what Meta has been doing is actually not that long ago, I think 1 year ago, we really said, okay, we're going to create a new pillar in the AI org, which is called the Societal and Responsible AI. And it's about, making sure that the AI we build is built responsibly. And then we have some teams that are responsible for establishing best practices. So we have, for instance, some kind of checklist or best practices guide in terms of, I want to make sure my model is not biased. What should I be doing? And they tell you, okay, you should evaluate it on all this kind of slice data set to compare, for instance, across genders, across age, across ethnicity, across world regions. Make sure that you don't have some specific combinations that have very high error rates, typically because you don't have enough data for these domains. And we even have a team which is a machine learning security team in some sense, that does multiple things. that is there to attack the models in some sense, right? To actually look at your model and tell you if they find something wrong with it. And it can be on the bias angle, but also like on the adversarial angle, like can you recover the training set from the model itself, for instance? Are there some clearly obviously wrong predictions that the model is doing? There have been some examples, including at Meta, of models making very embarrassing predictions on some of the inputs, like misclassifying some people from animals, these kind of things. It's something as well, you know, that we want to check for, and we're making sure that whatever we put in production, we're trying to make sure they're thoroughly tested to have these kinds of situations. So it's a big topic. There are lots of people working on it. Myself, the kind of applications I'm doing, they are not sensitive enough. That's a big deal right now.
Yeah, no, that's very interesting to hear. Like, I guess just kind of taking a pivot off of there, hearing kind of the many different roles and responsibilities just to build and maintain and then to review and evaluate and support these programs. I guess, do most of these positions at Meta require PhDs? I'm asking for a friend, do you need any school counselors there as well? who like bow ties?
So a school counselor positions, I don't know. What I would say, no, not most positions at Meta require a PhD. There is one position that requires a PhD, which is research scientist. So if you want to become a research scientist, you're going to need a PhD. That being said, what I would say is you can become a research engineer typically with master. With a bachelor, it may be possible, but we are going to need to have some previous experience in the industry doing machine learning applications. It's going to be harder. But if you become research engineer with a master, the frontier between research scientists and engineers actually blurry. So it's not really a binary thing. And you can start from the more engineering side and progressively over the years, move your way towards more scientific role. And, you know, we have some engineers now who are senior engineers. They prove themselves and they don't really care anymore about writing codes, and they're more driving research projects, and they're essentially acting like research scientists. They don't change their title to research scientist because they don't want to spend 3, 4, 5 years doing a PhD just to change their title. And it's totally fine as well. So no, you don't need a PhD in general. I would say most positions don't require a PhD.
Okay. That's really, I mean, it's fascinating to hear. And again, if you need any counselors, text me. one question that we do have is, are you seeing more women join your research teams or your other teams? And does Meta actively look to create diverse teams?
Yes, definitely. So that's a big yes. Unfortunately, I self-identify as a man, so I'm not the best example here. But we do have a strong diversity of inclusion efforts. So I think if you look up diverse something, you'll find some page on some of the programs we have externally facing. I would say that internally, first, we have some top-down recommendation to make sure we contribute to external community. This presentation I'm giving is actually, you know, to reach out to diverse people, hopefully, and get them excited about joining, doing this kind of career. So that's one example of how we are trying to get more women and other kinds of, you know, diverse people in the company. I would say, you know, whenever we hire someone, even for interns, we have a requirement that in the pipeline, we need, depending on the position, we need at least, you know, one or two or three diverse candidates that at least at the start of the pipeline to make sure enough they get a chance at least to prove themselves for the job. And we have an objective to have by 2025, 50% of Meta employees coming from underrepresented groups, at which point they won't be very much underrepresented anymore at Meta, which is really what we want, because we want to have as much diversity as possible. That being said, you know, there are challenges, not always possible. You know, it's not like sometimes there are some, you know, underrepresented groups are indeed underrepresented in general in tech. So there's a lot of competition out there. We don't always manage to get as diverse as we'd like to, but there's a lot of efforts towards this.
You know, as you're mentioning the pipeline, and I see that there's a diverse range of participants on this call right now from across the nation, many of whom are educators. What support did you receive or do you wish that you was received from an educator to get you involved in computing when you were younger or earlier, I guess?
That's a good question.
I actually didn't need to ask questions, so.
I don't think I received much because I've been, you know, I've been trying to get into just, I was basically, you know, I was basically starting school and trying to get with computers. And I've always been actively pursuing computer-oriented computer science things. So whatever has some kind of computer science in it, I would take that class. And so I don't think anyone really at any point, you know, had to help me figure out things. I guess it would have been nice, you know, for someone to tell me that machine learning was going to become hot 10 years in the future. It was really the right choice to do it because I got lucky with my roommate. If he hadn't been there, I have no idea where I would be right now myself. So, you know, if you have a counselor who has a crystal ball and can really predict what has the hot hot domains to look into, that'd be great. But I think that's a tough, obviously, tough task.
So what I hear you say is that more educators should participate in future advising careers like this webinar, so that they're on the cusp of things. With that being said, please go back in time and tell yourself to invest in Bitcoin as well.
Yeah, and don't do like myself and buy it some just right before it crashes.
Yeah.
Not a great idea.
I see one other question from Ali right now, who asks, what do you tell a student who says, I'm not good at math or cannot pursue a computer science type of career because they don't have a passion for math? What would you tell them?
So I think I'm not an educator. So the first thing I would try to understand is why do they struggle with math? And it's hard for me. I mean, I would try to see to which extent this is actually a blocker. What I would say is there are tons of programming computer science jobs where you don't need to do maths. I was insisting before on having some strong mathematical foundation. That's important. If you're going to do machine learning and work on machine learning, yes, please do the math, because you don't want to be one of these machine learning people who have no clue about what's actually going on, mathematically speaking, and then all bad things can happen. But you can definitely build some cool software without maths. That being said, I think, you know, for me, maths is essentially logic. It's about putting one and one together, and that makes two. Programming is a lot like this in the sense is, you know, you write down a bunch of statements and the machine spits out what you asked for. And it's really about logic and figure out how do you plug things together to get the results you want. So I'm not an education expert. I'm not a learning expert, but I do see some link between the two. So we say if there's something that you don't like or that you just are unable to get done in maths, you may face the same challenges in programming. I would say if that's not the case, you find yourself being super fluent in programming, able to really reason about how to organize programs, modularize them, achieve cool things, but you don't like math, you just hate math, that's totally fine as well. Just go and cut some cool stuff.
You know, I also hear like just things that resonated when I was listening to you talk, just from our earlier conversations. I mean, like your passion for curiosity, your passion for making connections, your passion for making discoveries. Like, those are things, again, which I think math is a beautiful language to answer those questions, but it's not exclusive to. And so those might be other avenues for engaging students as well. Just as we're wrapping up, just one question I had. I mean, like, I see the work that you're doing right now. I think it's phenomenal. I want to ask, like, in a world that's being constantly changed by things like code, being changed by things like AI and machine learning, how do you want to see the world change with the tools that you've been working with?
I guess the biggest thing top of mind for me is climate change. I think there's, you know, there's significant efforts towards AI for climate change, be it in, you know, making some stuff just less, pollute less, or finding new ways to helping us, you know, deal with this crisis that's coming up. I'm hoping that is going to be, you know, I'm really hoping it's going to save us, because I'm not super optimistic in that. So I guess that's really the big thing. I do think there are some big wins as well, that are possible, you know, in terms of healthcare, in terms of automation of some jobs, hopefully without disrupting too much the industry. I think there are enough challenges that are putting AI in production that is going to be slow enough that I think we have time to adapt. Just look at how long it's taking to get autonomous vehicles on the road, when in 2015 we are being told, oh yeah, they are coming. So I think we have some time for that, but it's going definitely to change things for the next decades.
That's fascinating. Well, I look forward to continuing to follow your work, and I really appreciate the time that we had to share today. So thank you very much.
Thank you. It was really great being here. Thanks, Stephen, for the question. And thanks, everyone, for the questions, and Stephen for translating them so well for me.
Merci.
Yeah, I want to thank both of you so much, and also to our attendees. We are really grateful that in this series, we're able to showcase all of these different careers and their intersection of computer science, as well as the varying levels of education that are needed for these. And one of the things, Olivia, that really stood out to me is that you said at one point that a friend kind of had that encouragement of getting involved in computers. And that's something that we really like to promote at NCWIT as well, is those small ways of encouraging our students to get involved in just a computer science class. We call that bridging the gap. And sometimes just having a friend invite another friend is what's going to spark that interest. And just for our attendees, I did drop that resource in there for some of the steps you can take to really start bridging that encouragement gap. But so thank you so much, both of you, Steve, for running that Q&A, and Olivier for that presentation. We really, really appreciate it. And for our attendees, I'd like to invite you all to our future webinars. You can read more about them and register at our Advising for Future Ready Careers landing page. And you can also sign up to receive updates about future webinars and programs from our NCWIT C4C just by filling out the link in the chat. Our upcoming webinar is with Citizen Schools, and it's a virtual coffee hour. We would love to have you register and attend that on March 23rd. And finally, look out for a survey in your email within the next few days. That is how you can receive your $25 Amazon gift card and resource kit when you fill out that survey with your school-based email address. And we thank you so much for your responses and for joining us today. We hope to see you at our next webinar then on March 23rd. Good night.